Yeah, good morning. We will discuss on the convolution neural networks in this class. Let me first share these slides. So let's discuss based on the whatever we had, the knowledge about neural networks. From your side, I would like to know why convolution neural networks or any other approach for deep learning is needed. So I would like to hear some of the points from you. What are the limitations of neural networks? And for image processing applications mainly, as well as for computer vision applications, okay, what are the, say, wishful kind of aspects, especially for applying a full automation task? Let it be classification, or let it be segmentation, or object detection, and so on. So I would like to hear some inputs from you before I start on to the convolution neural networks. Quick inputs. What are the first, let us start with what are the limitations of neural networks? None of you have any answer or what? Okay, so do you think that neural networks can be applied in all cases very effectively, and they can be used for learning of any classification task in large scale? Say, if I want to classify, or if I want to classify an object, okay, what are the challenges involved? Say, if I want to classify a person or not person, okay, that's a simple classification task I want to perform. What are the challenges involved?
Handling large data.
Handling large data, okay. What else? I just want to say I have an image. Okay, from that image, I want to tell whether there is a person or there is no person. What are the challenges involved?
Generally, in neural networks, we handpick the features and give it to the network.
Very good. Okay. So what's the consequence?
It's not always possible to get the features from the data.
Right. So the exactly which features to look, it may not be very clear in all cases. Okay. And the features that we would like to extract, for example, if you want to extract the length and width of a person or some dimensions of the person, it may or may not be very easy to do that. Okay, so some particular features may not be always available as well. Okay, fine, good. Any other inputs? What are the other challenges? Why the features may not be available? For example, I want to detect a face. Given a patch in an image, I want to tell whether there is a face or not. That's my like object detection task or face detection task. I want to pose it as a classification task. Okay, so what I want to do is I take a patch here. I just want to tell whether there is a face or not in that patch. So each patch I give it to a trained network. Okay, I want to tell whether there is a face or not. Okay, it does a binary classification. Face is there or not there? Yes, no. Answer. So to this kind of network, if it is trained like that, and if I keep giving the patches and want to classify as face or not face, what are the challenges involved? Yeah, I need some quick inputs. You can freely tell whatever you feel. Not necessarily there is some answer for it. So it's not a mathematical question. So 2 × 3 equal to how much?
The data we have might be very mixed. So in one, faces might be in different places of the image.
Right.
So I'm not sure if that would be easy to learn for a neural network.
Okay, fine. Assume that I have learned a neural network. Okay, but it's not easy to learn, you said. The reason we need to tell, that's the question. Second thing is, assume that I have a network which learns some kind of faces. Okay, so I have some data set with which I have cropped several faces where there are faces and different patches which having not faces, and trained a neural network and started with that. And then I want to know what are the limitations of it when I start doing it.
One thing, sir, even if you have like a binary classification like yes or no, you have to do a lot of computing. Compute is like a...
Fine, agree. But the question is, computation we'll get into a little later. But now, even for improving the accuracy, what are the challenges? Or performing the task, what are the challenges? I expect that you people might have also remembered some of the discussion that we had during the machine learning course. You can think of a practical scenario. Okay, I trained a neural network and started with it, and then start experimenting. What new changes may come for the input data?
There might be scale variations or rotations.
Very good. So the initial trained data, maybe with some trained network, maybe with the data having not much scale variations, and now more scale variations may come, rotations may come. Okay, what else?
Variations in intensity and noise.
Very good. So intensity variations of the training data and testing data may not match. What else? See, now let us bring in the discussion specifically to the neural network. Okay, we trained a neural network now. Okay, and then started doing this task of classification. So for a neural network, what are the limitations? So these are there for any classification method. In fact, in even now, neural network is also a classification method. So these rotations are small shifts. Why it fails? What is the reason for failing of that? So let us anyway review. So there are some good inputs. We have seen that extracting features may not be trivial in most of the cases. Okay, and then the data also may be varied. Most of the times it may have different variations in scale, orientation and position, okay, and intensity and so on, and view variations, which is other thing. Okay, given all these variations, it is not easy to learn the class labels. So let us see now what we can do better, how we can do better. So you people have seen in image processing task, if you want to extract some edges or features, what are the basic processes that we adopt is convolution, right? What's happening here? So this is finding edges in an image. So what are we doing here? Any of you can quickly tell, since we have discussed this before. Okay, can one of you tell what how we are getting these edges from this image? Yeah, how do you people get edges from an image?
We are performing convolution of the image with the filters.
Right. You are performing any convolution of the image with the filter. So what kind of filter are you taking for finding edges? Please tell.
It will be like a Sobel or those things.
Yeah, fine. Name-wise, it is a Sobel or Privet, fine. But what kind of filter? Filter, how does it look like is my question. See, if I want to find
the pixel intensities of two rows and columns,
it should be a
the difference in intensities of
two rows or columns. Okay, so if I want to find edge essentially is what the intensity variation across either rows or columns. Okay, so the filter also should imitate the kind of feature we want to extract, or the task we want to perform. So the filter is also having a variation. It's also like a step. Okay. So if you see this filter, it looks like a, so up, okay, and then flat, again up, and then flat. Okay, and so on. So it looks like again a steps. So if I see convolution with this filter, okay, what it does effectively the differencing between the previous row to current row, okay, and then gives me in some sense the effective change across that row, right? And that is considered as the edge. Okay, a horizontal edge means the variation in row across rows. Vertical edge means variation across columns. Okay, so we define horizontal as this and vertical as this. Based on that, we say that this is the horizontal edge, okay, and this is vertical edge. Okay, so the filter also will look exactly like that, right? So what the and after doing with this kind of what is the process that we do with this? This filter we do with, what do we do with this filter and the image? We apply this filter on the image through what operation?
Correlation.
Either correlation or convolution. Okay, we can do either of them. If we think in terms of systems perspective, what we are doing is the output is the edge. Okay, and the system is finding edges. Okay, and then we say that it is convolution. And just the filter anyway, it doesn't matter much, once here or minus once here. Okay, we are, because we are applying all through. Similarly, the other one. So that then we call convolution. If we are finding the features similar to the edge, if I interpret as the edge filter, and I am trying to find out the features similar to the edge, I say that it is correlation. Okay, and then find out the correlation, and then give wherever the information in this image is looking similar to this filter, I want to highlight it. Okay, fine. Assume that I have performed a convolution or correlation. Just to conclude the or the complete the discussion that we had on edge detection, directly after convolution of this with the either of these filters, you will get, will you get this? Can you just complete the discussion on the edge detection? How do you, what are the performing next steps you need to perform to get this?
Thresholding.
Thresholding. So you make the thresholding of, because what if you correlate with them, these regions of interest will be highlighted. Once you make a highlight, then you need to separate them, means you need to apply a threshold. Okay, below a threshold you knock off, above a threshold you put them in white. Okay, so it's thresholding is as nothing but a kind of activation function kind of thing, is it not? So the first thing that we are doing is convolution is some kind of these, you consider these itself as the weight elements. Okay, then what we are doing with a kernel of some weight elements, I am doing performing convolution operation to get my the net value. Okay, the net value at that layer. Okay, and on that net value, what theory we do, especially in neural networks, we apply an activation that's like a thresholding operation here. Okay, but however, do you think that to get the edges just convolving with this or with this, is that enough? Or what do you do? Do you convolve with this or with this? With the horizontal edge kernel or vertical edge kernel?
We convolve with both.
And add, yeah, we convolve with both, and then what do?
Add the absolute value.
Yeah, so in some sense, either add the absolute value or root mean square of these two results you take as the final result, and then on the top of it, you threshold. So it is not necessary or it is not sufficient to extract the features only through a single kernel. Okay, if you want to perform some of the image processing operation, you may need to perform several, like the feature extraction with several kernels and the interaction of these feature maps. Okay, the convolution results of different filters will help us to get into the required solution. This is even for a image processing task. Okay, the similar inference will also help for the subsequent little high level computer vision task. Okay, finding out the objects, okay, and localizing the objects and recognizing the objects and so on. So this is one intuition on how the feature extraction can be done more effectively in images. Okay, so far when we discuss about neural networks and any other classifiers, we don't use the knowledge of image processing or domain knowledge. Okay, So are even the spatial neighborhood importance of spatial neighborhood in processing. No, we all just make it as a vector and then put it to the network and try to take the features directly and then try to classify. Here we are concentrating not just on the classification task, but also on the feature extraction part. I hope this is clear. And this can be feature extraction can be very effectively done through convolution operation. Okay. And that's what, but single convolution may not be sufficient. You may need a set of kernels to extract different features. Okay. And they are encoded in terms of feature maps and then some activation functions to combine. Okay. And subsequently some kind of other convolution operations together to combine effectively is needed. Okay. So is this analogy clear? And I hope you know very well on the convolution operation. So I'm skipping this slide, putting the, you give the kernel on the image at different locations of the image and then keep the weighted addition of information between the kernel weights and the image elements or image pixels to give the net convolution value. Okay, so and not just the edge detection, many of the other image processing operations can also be encoded in terms of convolution operation. So this I think we have discussed before, but to not like to bring in little of the domain aspects as well, these which will help us to understand the applications better, I'm discussing again or asking in terms of questions now. Okay, so from this image to this image, what do you think is the change? And when this may come instead of this image? A quick answer is welcome.
The image, the second image is basically blurred version of the first.
Right. So when do you think this kind of image will come as the output of a camera? I'm not doing any image processing. I'm just capturing an image, but my image is like this. So what does it mean? What's happening?
Camera might be in the motion.
Yeah, there is either a car is moving and then from that moving car, we have a camera and we have taken a person, like a image of a person. Okay, or if the object is moving and we have taken the image of the moving object. So when there is a relative motion between the camera and the object we are imaging, we'll have a blur. So that kind of blur is referred to as motion blur. Okay, the smear will happen either in the direction of motion. Okay, it will just smear means during the exposure time, it will average all the pixels that it sees, the camera sees, and use the average intensity of all several pixels it sees. Not just the same location it sees. Okay. Usually what happens if you are with a stand by camera and with a steady object, if you take the during exposure time, the field of view is constant. Okay. And hence you take just the average of the intensities in that region. There is no moving things. Okay. But during the motion of the object, instead of averaging in a single field of view, it looks at 10 field of views or 5 field of views of different locations of the object, not just single location. Okay. And then because of that, there is a smear or blur. Okay. So this can be considered as by the imaging time or imaging modality itself, you have introduced a convolution operation. Okay. Convolution with this kind of kernel. Okay. So we are all 1/5, 1/5 and so on. Okay. If you average and put, this is what you have captured. Okay, G itself is this. Okay, what we need is F. Okay, original image. So in such case, what you already did a convolution to capture this. So you need to do deconvolution or perform convolution with an inverse filter of H. Okay, if you roughly can imagine what H is, you can also construct an inverse filter and then do inverse filter convolution of G with HI. Okay, inverse filter and you can get F. Okay, assuming that there is not much noise. If there is noise, still you can go into the frequency domain and do better. Okay, so hope this is clear. So here also, what I'm trying to say is different image processing operations require convolution operation as the key, okay, to make their processing. And this also forms a key, convolution operation is also an important for feature extraction that we have seen before. And this is for different image processing operations also, convolution plays a great role. So designing how the convolution kernels is a very important task. Okay, so that this example proves that. So face detection was a challenge, okay, before 2001. Okay, and the reason is, as we have discussed, the view of the faces may be quite different. Okay, and the scale of the faces may be different. Okay, and then the look of the faces, the face itself may be different from person to person or several persons. Okay, and there are several challenges because of the color, intensity variations, and other variations. So given all this, so background clutter and many other things, given all this, detecting the faces in an image itself was a challenging task. Okay, and there was good research on that. And finally, one of the very celebrated method during 2001s is the face detection by Weyla and Jones. What it did is, it used very simple kernels or simple feature extraction masks to tell that this is the rough localization of the face. Okay, so what they have noted is, in face, there is a bright region here and a dark region here. Okay, so if you put a kernel of this sort, okay, and which is to be dark in either side and bright this side, okay, this kind of kernel, just opposite of this kind of kernel. Okay, then you can say that dark, this kind of kernel itself, it highlights the face region. So you see this correlation of this kernel with respect to the face. If you do, wherever the face nose location is there, this will give a high score. So it will localize roughly this face. Similarly, this kind of kernel will indicate that the eyes are darker and this region is brighter. Okay, or this region is brighter. Okay, so you can see that this kind of kernels will enable us to easily identify or locate the face. So the elegance of this method lies in designing this kernel itself. Okay, and this kernel is very simple kernel, where you just need to do additions and subtractions, nothing else. And hence, the real-time face detection became possible. In fact, in most of the cameras, this is what is used. Okay, Weyla and Jones method for face detection. So there are several other steps in addition to this, but this is the key step. So what I'm trying to stress here is, we have seen that feature extraction can be effectively done by the convolution operation with different kernels. And we also have seen that image processing operations can also be done through convolution operation. Now we are seeing that the kernel which use for a particular processing or for particular task has to be very well designed, okay, to make that processing very effective or highly accurate. Okay, so how to find out the kernels for convolution which will extract the features for a given task are very, very important or challenging problem. Whether knowingly or unknowingly, people hit on the same, and they could come up with the method called convolution neural networks, which will effectively extract the features through convolution operation and learn the convolution through the backpropagation idea of neural networks, the kernels itself, which are suitable to extract good, very good features. Also, on the features, importance of features, I hope we have discussed enough in the previous course on MLIP. The feature extraction is very important part. So it has to be invariant to view variations, scale, and then intensity variations and so on. So one typical features that are more effective are known to be more effective are histogram of orientation gradient features, where we find the histogram of the orientations, orientation gradients, that is the edge gradients, or the angle of edges, okay, at each location, and form a histogram in a local neighborhood and say that this is the dominant orientation in that region through the histogram. And that will help us to encode the shape of the object. Okay. And this kind of things can also be effectively, this were known to be very effective in computer vision. Okay. And this also needs the primitive steps through convolution operations. Okay. And subsequently on some kind of, okay, gathering of information or the compact representation of the information, and then giving the shape based features. So we will see now, this is one of the celebrated method for human non-human detection. So we'll see now how the convolution operation or convolution neural networks facilitate all this okay, in terms of feature extraction, and learn the features in themselves. Okay, so this is on the feature extraction part and learning the features. There is other very elegant, the importance for the convolution neural networks, or the capability that they have is much beyond that. So the reason is, see, for example, in conventional classification task, where we started the automating the fish classification, what were the initial steps we said? We have a pre-processing, feature extraction, and classification. In this, which are domain dependent and which are not domain dependent, can one of you tell quickly?
Pre-processing and feature extraction are domain dependent.
Right. We know that feature extraction and pre-processing are domain dependent, and classification is can be made independent of the domain once we have enough features, good features. So, but the question is, see, if I keep the feature extraction for each domain different, okay, and if I keep extracting the features, the applicability of the method is only limited, okay, to that domain. I can't have a generic approach which will be applicable to various applications or various domains. So the CNNs, as I said, have the elegance to extract the features themselves through convolution operation and backpropagation. Okay, and if that is the case, then they can be applied across different domains, because they don't make the feature extraction step, okay, independent or separate from the classification step. They learn not just the classification, okay, but also the feature extraction stage. In fact, they do learn the pre-processing stage, okay, where we have seen in deep learning. So it's a kind of pre-processing where we want to, from the blurred image to deep blur. Okay, so they can learn in some sense the feature extraction, pre-processing, and classification together. And hence their applicability become much more wider, and their the accuracies also have boosted very well. Okay, and their importance and the the rigor in which they can be applied, what's much more higher than all the earlier methods, many other earlier methods. Okay, so you can see that in image processing, we need different kind of features for speech, different kind of features, and text, different kind of features. Now the CNNs has the capability, or even deep learning methods overall have the capability to do that. Also, RNNs also have the capability in some applications where especially there is a sequence of images or sequence of information. Also, temporal aspect to this. Fine. So now let us get into the limitations of the neural networks. So far we have seen the limitations of the, like, applying the neural networks to the data. Okay. Now let us see the limitations of neural network itself. So in performing their classification task. So what is this? Can you tell now what this picture depicts? Okay, what? So this picture and the information that is given here, what does this infer to you? So I need some quick inputs, because anyway, this can be clearly conveyed, but I want you to understand and convey what is this, the equations and the pictures together, okay, indicate here. Yeah, quick answer is welcome. The question is, if I give this to you, if I show this to you, what do you infer? What can you say? I need some quick answer. Say F equal to W2, matrix W2 into max of 0, comma W1, comma into X is written. Okay, from that, what do you infer? First of all, by looking at the figure, what do you infer?
This is a two-layer neural network, and the second equation is actually net2.
Okay, very good. That's fine. And what are the activation functions that are used?
I use ReLU activation function.
Where?
Like max of 0, W1x.
Yeah, that's fine. In which layer then?
First layer.
Yeah, in first layer, they have used ReLU activation function. Okay, and then if you consider F directly as the output, then you are using linear activation function here, okay, to get this course, right? So you are not using any activation function or nonlinear activation function in the second layer, right? So that's what it indicates. And these are visualization of what? What do you think these are? These are roughly the weights, say when I say particular output, to that particular output neuron, if I see all the connections of the inputs, okay, so it forms a 30272 cross 1 matrix. Okay, if I assume that I don't have the intermediate one, directly I connect all these two output neuron, okay, of a particular class, so particular output neuron, so car class output neuron. Then I have 30272 cross 1 weight elements connected to this particular neuron. Those I reshape in terms of what? Reshape in terms of, see this image, each image are 32 cross 32 cross 3. So I reshape these weights also in terms of 32 cross 32 cross 3. And then I can look at as this is the template that these weights are learning. Okay, essentially it's depicting the same object class. Okay, it's depicting the average of object class and in some sense the features that, okay, the network is capturing in terms of already captured through learning. Okay. Is this clear or not? And if you see a different, say, aeroplane class, then it should look like somewhat similar to aeroplane. Well, that's essentially is the understanding. So now let us see the limitations of neural networks. Okay. So what is the first limitation? I think anyway, we can tell we have been discussing on the limitations of neural networks. So I wish you to tell at least a couple of limitations from your side. What are the limitations of applying neural networks to a classification task of say large number of classes, okay, and then large data and so on, or when we want to have a neural network with large number of layers and so on? Yeah, quick inputs. What is the first limitation which is shown here?
It's hard for the initial layers to learn when we have deep learning.
Right. The reason is you're multiplying with several activation functions in the back propagation. Okay. And then each activation function, if you consider as the sigmoid activation function, the range of the values that activation f dash can take is only 0.25, maximum of 0.25, 0 to 0.25. And hence the weight update of all the initial layers will become close to zero and they don't update. Diminishing gradients problem that you have. Okay. And you can, the suggestion for this is you can use the activation functions like ReLU activation function. Okay. So the other limitation of neural networks is this. Okay. What is this picture depicting? This also you might have seen before, or you can easily infer from this. What is this slide depicting? The limitation of neural network. Other limitation. A quick answer again. You can't see anything here. Okay, Srihari, you want to tell?
Actually, we can't capture the spatial information.
Okay, that's fine. What else? Like, Kishore?
The relationship between the intensity changes and that all we lost information, like spatial information of the image, basically.
Yeah, that is fine. Spatial information is lost. That is that point is well taken. That's correct. So because anyway you are bringing these, if you directly take the pixels as the features, you are bringing to one dimension.
And also the computations will be lost.
Yeah, that is also fine. There is one more very important thing that's depicted here. Yeah, Deepanshu?
Yes, sir.
Distortion. Yeah.
Huh? It's not illness.
variation in the same input, in like a distortions and this.
So what does it affect? So if there is a variation in input, how does it affect? You should give me a complete sentence. So it's...
It will be hard for the neural network for class to classify that there is a lot of distortion in the image.
Yeah, that's fine. So you are referring probably to this. So there may be some like missing information. Oh, wow. Yeah. But still, a few more inputs. Yes, Neha? Yeah, you can tell. Somebody is trying to tell.
Yeah, a neural network would learn also the positional information of an object, maybe given the training data, but the testing data, the object of interest might be in another position and it would be difficult for it to identify.
Correct. So see, it might have assumed that A means always these are black, okay, and then these are white. So if we assume that background is white and foreground is black, but during testing, this may be black and this may be white. Is it not? So it's all just the complementary is what is happening. All these like neurons corresponding to this were fired during training. Okay, assume that during training, we only fire the neurons corresponding to this saying that there is an A here. But while testing, it's all just shifted. So completely different input we are giving when we make one dimension. Is it not? So that gives a complete different positional encoding. And hence, the neural network may not be comfortable in testing with small shifts. Okay, orientation changes, all those aspects, right? Okay, so this is another major. So the first point that you have mentioned is the spatial information is lost. Okay, neighborhood information is lost. Second point is even with small shifts, rotations and all those things, the positional encoding are exactly in the same position. Okay, tying to the corresponding weights may not be a good thing. Okay, and it will not be able to, it is not generic enough to learn for shifts and orientation changes, right? So, and hence we need an approach which essentially, can combine feature extraction stage with the classification stage. And it should be somewhat invariant, if not completely invariant, to shift and distortions. Okay, and such a network is convolution neural network. Okay, so I probably will conclude the class here and we will discuss on the convolution neural networks and backpropagation in the convolution neural network tomorrow. I think there is a class tomorrow, right? So because of the timetable change. So we will discuss
Friday.
Yes, Friday's timetable is tomorrow. So let us discuss tomorrow in the first class, CNN and classification. So backpropagation of CNNs. What I would suggest is inform you, those who are here and those who are not here also, don't miss the classes of CNN, especially CNN and backpropagation in CNNs. They are not easy to understand. And if you have any questions, you can easily raise. They are not very well documented as well. There are books probably discussed in different manners and even video lectures. But the backpropagation aspect is not... something which is not very well discussed in many of the places. There was some earlier students who worked out very well in our group. So we have some good, different material on that. Thank you. Yeah, if you have any quick questions, we can take. Otherwise, we can leave. Bye.